Hello students, this video is in continuation with my previous two video on pollination mechanism in living gymnosperms, where I shared with you general introduction of pollination mechanism in gymnosperm as well as detailed mechanism of pollination in cycadales and coniferales. And in this video I am going to share with you pollination mechanism in gingoils and nettles. Before we start, let's watch some field experiences shared by my student Chetna Thakur regarding the Pinus valchiana. Students, this is image of Pinus valchiana having mature male cones ready for pollination and what type of pollens they shed. Is pollination in gingoils. Pollination in gingoils is anemophilous as in most of the gymnosperms. The cells of the nucellar beak present in the pollen chamber disintegrate and form a viscous fluid. This fluid is cohesive in nature and fluid oozes out of the micropylar and collect in the form of a pollen drop. Students, here is image of mature male cone of Gingko biloba having pollen grains. The pollen grains present in the air current are entangled in the pollination drop, and you can see in this image drop at the top of the ovule. Gradually the pollen drop dries up and the pollen grains are sucked into the pollen chamber through micropyle. Further drying of this drop seals up the micropyle. Pollination in Gingko biloba takes place sometime in April. At the time of pollination, the ovule secretes a mucilaginous substance. Further development of the male gametophyte takes place in the pollen chamber. Students, the pollen grains are dispersed by the wind to the female ovulate cone, where a pollen grain lands close enough to the tip of an ovule. It is drawn in through the micropyle, often by means of pollination drop. And students, withdrawal of pollen grains by micropyle or through pollination drop is very special in gingoils, and that is facilitated by the evaporation and secretion of the pollination drop. The pollen enters a pollen chamber close to the nucellus and there it waits for a year before it germinates and forms a pollen tube that grows through the wall of megasporangium where fertilization takes place. In pollen chamber, the generative cells of the four-celled young male gametophyte divide into a stalk cell, which is close to the second prothelial cell, and a body cell. So finally, it becomes five-cell stage. Now the entine protodue out near the pore and function as a pollen tube. The pollen tube swells up and advances toward the archegonia by protruding into the nucellus. Just before fertilization, the body cell divide into two and the wall formation is at right angle to the base of the pollen grains. The blepharoplast appear on the body of these so formed two cells, which function as a multiflagellated sperms or male gamete. So student, this is a similar traits which is shared by the gingoils and cycads. You know, both show living fossils in gymnosperm, and in both cases you will find flagellated sperms. So here you can see developmental changes in case of pollen grain, and finally you can see that at the right angle division takes place and finally two multiflagellated sperms are produced. These sperms are carried to the female gametophyte through the pollen tube. So here both pseudogamy and siphonogamy occur, and you see tube show hyphae like growth of the pollen tube, and it is multi-branched or hostorial in nature, which carries mature male gametophyte to the female gametophyte to assist further fertilization and development of seed. So that's all about the pollination in gingoils. Next is pollination in nettles. Students, Neetum has long been regarded as insect pollinated due to its range restricted distribution in tropical rainforest, where bean pollination is supposed to be detrimental. Means Neetum are restricted to the rainforest, that's why they prefer endomophily, that is fertilization with the help of insect. However, ubiquitous pollen limitation in the tropic might cause transition to anemophily or even ambophily. Ambophily here means pollination by both insect as well as wind. For reproductive assurance, especially for gymnosperms such as Neetum, which exhibit various anemophilous syndrome, including absence of petals, greenish color of the strawberry, dioecious and uniovulate flowers. Students, both wind and biotic pollination contributed to seed production of Neetum parviflorum. The occurrence of ambophily in Neetum and the prevalence of anemophily in Ephedra and Welwitschia suggests that wind may also play a role in pollination of the ancient Neetales. Neetum possesses morphologically bisexual but functionally unisexual reproductive structure that excludes sugary pollination drop to attract insect. So here you will find at the male plant, you will see both male and female are present, but female are sterile in nature. Let's see pollination in Ephedra. Students, most gymnosperms are wind pollinated, but some are insect pollinated. And in Ephedra, both wind pollination and insect pollination occur. Little is, however, known about mechanism and evolution of pollination syndrome in gymnosperm. Ephedra faumina, it is pollinated by Dipterian and Lepidopterian. Most of them are nocturnal. And its pollination coincides with the full moon of the July. So we also recognize pollination in Ephedra with the help of moonlight. This may be adaptive in two ways. Many nocturnal insects navigate using the moon. Further, spectacular reflection of the full moonlight in the pollination drop is the only apparent mean of nocturnal attraction of insect in these plants. Students, insect pollination is an ancestral state in Neetum. The sister species of the remaining Ephedra, that is Ophedra faumina, is insect pollinated, as are Welwitschia and Neetum, and probably also Ephedra aphylla. By contrast, other species of Ephedra are considered wind pollinated. As most gymnosperm, Ephedra produce liquid by secretion from the nucellus, and the liquid is exposed as the pollination drop at the micropylar opening. Students, in this image you can see mature male cone bearing pollen grains in Ephedra. Students, in this slide you can see pollination drop present in the ovule of female cone, and you can see that both insect and wind pollination takes place in the Neetales. Neetum prefers insect pollination. Likewise, in Ephedra both wind and insect pollination takes place. However, some species like Ephedra aphylla and Ephedra foramina, insect pollination takes place, while Welwitschia, again, insect pollination occur. The main function of pollination drop is to receive and transport pollen to the nucellus. But in Neetales, the pollination drop are high in sugar and therefore attractive to insects. In wind pollinated Ephedra, Distichia pollination is not correlated to the full moon but occur at approximately the same dates every year. The lunar correlation has probably been lost in most species of Ephedra. Subsequent and evolutionary shift to wind pollination in the clade when the service of the insect are no longer needed for successful pollination. The adaptive value of correlating pollination with the full moon is lost and conceivably also the trait. Next is pollination in Neetum. Students, you know very well, Neetum is dioecious. The reproductive organs are organized into well-dwelt cone or strobili. These cones are organized into inflorescence, generally of panicle type. Sometimes the cones are terminal in position. Due to Their arrangement in the inflorescence, they are quite often named as flower in neatum. A cone consists of cone axis at the base of which are present two opposite and conate bracts. Nodes and internodes are present in the cone axis. Whorls of the circular bracts are present on the node. These are arranged one above the other to form cupule or collar. Students, you can see in this image node and internodes. While you can see here, bracts are organized to form perianth. The male cones are arranged in definite ring above each collar on the nodes of the axis of male cone, as you can see in this image. The number of ring varies between 3 to 6. The male flower in the ring are arranged alternately. There is ring of abortive ovule or imperfect female flowers above the ring of the male flowers. As you can see in this image, here is ring of abortive ovule over the female flower. Each male flower contains two coherent bracts which form the perianth, as you can see in this image. Two unilocular anthers remain attached on a short stalk enclosed within the perianth. At maturity, when the anthers are ready for descent, the stalk elongates and the anther comes out of the perianth sheath. In neatum neemone, a few flowers are sometimes seen fusing with each other, as you can see in last image. Friends, you can see here neatum neemone having fused anther. And in earlier two images, you can see abortive female ovule over the male flower and spiral collar in the male inflorescence. Students, a dioecious shrub species of Neatum neemone variety Tenerum flowered in the evening and strawberry emitted a stinking odor. Pollination droplets were secreted from the ovule on female strawberry and formed sterile ovule on the male strawberry in the evening. These strawberry were visited by nectar-seeking moth of Pyralidae and Geometridae. Sticky pollen was attached on the proboscides and antennae of these moths. A dioecious buticlimber, Neatum capsipidatum, had colleen strawberry on booty stem near the forest floor. Its male strawberry emitted a fungus-like odor in the evening and secreted nectar on the collar that subtended flower rings. The strawberry were visited by small flies of Xenilidae diptera into the antennae and legs of which pollen was attached. Evaporation of the exposed droplet nectar of these neatum flowers seemed to be minimized by nocturnal flowering near the tropical rainforest floor. Another floral structure constraint of gymnosperm are lack of showy petal was compensated by the floral fragrancy. The prevalence of entomophily in the nettles, that is Neatum, Ephedra and Welwitschia, may suggest that unspecialized insect pollination originated before the divergence between nettles and angiosperm. So students, that's all about the pollination mechanism in living gymnosperm. And to conclude, I must say that in cycadales and nettles, you will find insect pollination, which is considered as a primitive traits. While in coniferales and gingoils, you will find wind pollination, and that is considered a advanced trait in gymnosperm. And as I explained in my first video, that there are various adaptive mechanism to facilitate this wind and insect pollination. So that's all about the topic. I hope you understood it. Thanks for listening.